Hello everybody, I'm back reacting to the Post Office Inquiry IT scandal, the scam. The reason for the long pause, by the way, is because I tried to do something new to improve the sound and picture quality, and ironically, you just can't depend on computer working, can you? You can't depend on technology, and it didn't work. Now, thanks for watching and keeping interested in the inquiry.
Can you give your full name, please?
Andrew Paul Parsons.
You are currently a partner at Bumblebone Dickinson?
Yes.
You began your career there as a trainee, I think in 2006, when it was Bond Pierce, is that correct?
Yes.
You qualified in September 2008 and joined the Southampton office?
Yes.
You became a senior associate in 2012?
Yes.
You became partner in 2016?
Yes.
We know from phase four of this inquiry that Bond Dickinson was involved in civil actions against our postmasters from the early time when you were qualified as a solicitor, so the early years of your qualification. We heard from, for example, Stephen Dilly, who was involved in the Castleton case. Was that something you were aware of when you qualified?
I was aware of the Castleton case.
Your main involvement in Horizon, I think, was from April 2013, is that correct?
That's correct.
When you first started working on those Horizon-related matters, as a senior associate, who did you report to within Bond Dickinson?
Gavin Matthews.
In terms of the post office, who were your main points of contact at that stage?
Initially it was Roderick Williams, and then later Susan Crichton.
And what was your view as to their competence and abilities?
They both seemed like experienced in-house lawyers.
Taking you to the Helen Rose report, the 12th of June 2013, so soon after your Horizon work began. The sub-postmaster in this case had denied carrying out a transaction, and there was an investigation. She says there the Fujitsu logs were requested for this branch, but whilst waiting for these to arrive, communications took place with Gareth Jenkins at Fujitsu for more details to gain an understanding what had occurred at this branch. Just pausing there, Gareth Jenkins, was that somebody who you were aware of, even in broad terms, in April 2013 or thereabouts?
Thereabouts or shortly thereafter.
Questions asked and extracts from various emails in response. So we've seen this plenty of times. There are a set of questions that Helen Rose has asked and answers that have been provided by Gareth Jenkins. Over the page, she says, question, I can see where this transaction is and now understand the reason behind it. My main concern is that we use the basic ARQ logs for evidence in court. And if we don't know what extra reports to ask for, then in some circumstances we would not be given a true picture. I know you are aware of all the Horizon integrity issues, and I want to ensure that the ARQ logs are used and understood fully by our operational teams who have to work with this data, both in interviews and in court. Recommendations, I do believe that the system has behaved as it should, and I do not see this scenario occurring regularly and creating large losses. However, my concerns are that we cannot clearly see what has happened on the data available to us, and this in itself may be misinterpreted when giving evidence and using the same data for prosecutions. Now, you've set out in your witness statement why, in your view, this wouldn't have changed the picture very much. We can see that this report was sent to you, Dave Posner to Roderick Williams. Roderick, please find associated a report from our fraud analyst, Helen Rose, in respect of Lepton SPSO. This office doesn't feature as part of our second site spot reviews. Just pausing there, by this stage, so the summer of 2013, I think you were involved in those second site spot reviews, is that correct?
I was assisting the post office with drafting the responses to the spot reviews.
Thank you. But the subject matter is Horizon, and indeed Credence related. Could I ask that you consider the report and feed any comments back, as it could be a potential issue at some stage? In summary, the specifics concern a system reversal of a transaction following a system failure. This is normal practice, but the Horizon logs and Credence logs indicate that the reversal is an existing reversal, implying that the reversal was manually entered by the clerk slash sub-postmaster. I think there's a remote possibility that this could be a problem in terms of using the data for evidence slash prosecution purposes, But nevertheless, it is still a possibility. Myself or Helen are happy to talk through anything that requires explanation. We can see Roderick Williams sends it to you on the 3rd of July 2013, and he says, Andy, can you take a look at this so you can give me an overview on the phone sometime today? And he attaches there the Helen Rose report. Now, I think you said in your statement that you don't recall receiving the report. Is that correct?
I don't recall receiving the report, no.
I mean, looking at this email, it is likely that you did receive the Helen Rose report on the 3rd of July.
Yes.
And it is likely that you considered its contents?
Correct.
You would have seen the wording at the bottom, the concerns that are raised by Dave Posnett.
I would have focused on the aspects of that report that were talking about transaction reversals, because that was the same issue that had arisen in spot review number one that I've looked at recently.
Okay. I mean, the report itself is not very long, it's 4 pages, so it's likely, isn't it, that you would have read the report? I mean, it's actually 3 pages of text and 1 page of front page.
Yeah, I accept I would have read the report. Yeah.
Moving on to the suspense account bug, I think at that time it was the 14 bug, or referred to that, the number 14 because of the number of branches that it was known to have affected. Is that correct?
Correct.
We can see an email from Ben Thorpe, who was in the post office legal team.
He was a secondee from Bond Dickinson to the post office legal team.
Thank you. In fact, that's how he introduces himself at the beginning of this email. He says, by way of a very brief introduction, my name is Ben Thorpe. I am a Bond Dickinson secondee from the Newcastle office, currently working with Roderick Williams in the post office's legal team for the next few weeks. We have received the attached query from the business regarding historical issues a very limited number of branches had with Horizon. Post office intends to refund any losses caused by these issues, but not seek to recover any gains. Could you please review the letters and let Roderick and me have any comments you may have, particularly in the context of the spot reviews? If you'd like to discuss anything arising from your review, please do give either Roderick or me a call. Your response. But you say, Ben, Roderick, to be honest, I don't quite follow the logic of Andy Wynne's letters. I suspect this is just me, and this makes perfect sense to the sub-postmasters. The risk here is that disclosing any form of an error in Horizon could become problematic if it ends up in the hands of the Justice for Sub-Postmasters Alliance. However, we have no real option but to disclose this issue and make right the error with the sub-postmasters that have been affected. To do otherwise risks damaging the post office's credibility on Horizon and severe criticism from the Federation. My suggestion, therefore, is to make sure that we understand the root cause of this error before going public. Hopefully this will give us a good explanation as to why this one error does not undermine our general view that Horizon is otherwise robust. With that in mind, are you happy for me to speak to Simon Baker, Andy Wynne, to get some more background / technical details? So you say that hopefully this will give us a good explanation as to why this one error does not undermine our general view that Horizon is otherwise robust. Were you concerned on reading that it was a possibility that general view could have been undermined?
At this stage, I didn't understand the nature of the error in hardly any detail. I was also only about 2 months into working for the post office in earnest, so my understanding of Horizon was pretty limited. So I wanted to understand more information before forming that view.
The letters by this stage have been drafted and sent to you for review. You are now responding to Roderick Williams, and you say, I've reviewed the sub-postmaster letters. I've attached markups of the two letters which show the suggested amendments that should be made across all the letters. And you set out in bullet points the various amendments that you've made. But the first to insert an opening paragraph that explains the post office's investigation and highlights the fact that we have sought to protect sub-postmasters from any harm in the interim period. To remove the word problem and replace this with less dramatic word issue. Just pausing there, was that your own initiative? Was that something that you were aware of, that the business wasn't happy with certain language?
No, I had no instructions as to use of particular language. I think it's a fairly ordinary thing for lawyers to do to soften wording in letters.
You say, I don't think we should apologise in the letters. I know this sounds hard, but in apologising, we are admitting some degree of culpability. I think we should maintain a more cold procedural approach to correcting what is effectively an accounting irregularity. Is that, again, something you did your own initiative without instructions on that particular matter?
Yes, these are my recommendations to Post Office.
In some circumstances, it appears that an error caused a transaction record from a former sub-postmaster at a branch to be carried over into the records of a later sub-postmaster at the same branch. In my view, this is a dangerous admission, as the complete separation between sub-postmaster records is a cornerstone principle of ensuring Horizon's integrity. Although this has happened and is completely explainable, I don't think we ever want to expressly document this. Are you saying in that final bullet point that it's such an important issue for Horizon that you don't think that it should be documented?
I'm talking here in the context of these letters, which are individual letters to go to individual sub-postmasters.
And why wouldn't you want to expressly document something that is the cornerstone of ensuring Horizon's integrity?
We're talking here about these particular letters. This isn't advice to suggest that the whole issue should not be documented.
And why wouldn't you want to document it in those letters?
Because each letter was individual to each branch. Each one was customised. And so it dealt with the issue in that individual branch.
But why wouldn't it matter? Why would you be concerned about expressly documenting something? Is it because you would be concerned about disclosure, for example, in other cases?
But disclosure of this issue may have come out anyway because the issue was documented in other documents. What I'm talking about here is the individual letters. Each one was customised for each individual sub-postmaster to reflect their position and how it impacted on them.
I'm not too sure how that answers the question that I've just asked, though, which is about disclosure in other cases. Were you concerned that by documenting it in these particular cases, it would then be on record to be disclosed in other matters? Was that a concern that you had that is expressed in this bullet point?
If it had been documented in those letters, then yes, it would have been disclosable in other matters. But my point being is there would have already been in existence documents about this issue.
And was a concern that you had that if you documented it, it would then become disclosable in other matters?
I don't believe I gave it that level of thought.
You were, at this time, summer of 2013, concerned about expressly documenting matters relating to Horizon integrity.
Again, this is in the context of letters to individual sub-postmasters. It's not a general observation on how Post Office should document problems in Horizon.
Can we please have a look at the letters? Because these are your amendments to the letters. This is to a sub-postmaster, and it says, I'm aware that you've communicated previously with our current agents team in relation to two unexplained discrepancies that have impacted your branch. Thanks for alerting us to the issue. So this is a letter where someone has already made a complaint and it's responding to their specific complaint.
That's what I understood. Yes.
And you've added this. You've added, in light of these discrepancies, Post Office has thoroughly investigated your branch's records, and whilst undertaking this investigation, we have ensured that any known discrepancies have not been charged to your account. I write now to confirm the outcome of our investigations. What was the thorough investigation that had taken place?
This was information provided to me by Andy Wynne of Post Office.
This was your insertion into a draft letter. What investigations have you carried out that the Post Office had thoroughly investigated the branch's records?
I have personally not carried out any investigations.
Were you nevertheless comfortable in inserting that addition?
Those were my instructions from Andy Wynne.
I can confirm, and then you speak about the gains, and then we see that you've changed the word problem to issue. You've struck out the words by the former sub-postmaster. Is that because, as you identified in that previous email, that at the cornerstone of ensuring Horizon's integrity was the separation between sub-postmasters' accounts?
That's what I understood at the time.
And thereby, by removing reference to the former sub-postmaster, it would not be clear to the person reading this letter that strict division between sub-postmasters' accounts had not in fact functioned on that occasion.
I think it would have been possible for the the sub-postmaster to have worked that out because it mentions 2010 TP8 is trading period 8, so they would have known whether that happened whilst they were the sub-postmaster or not.
So why strike it out?
Because I didn't think it was relevant to this particular sub-postmaster.
It's not because you didn't think it was relevant. We can go back to those bullet points if you want, but you said in that final bullet point that it is my view this is a dangerous admission, as a complete separation between sub-postmasters' records is a cornerstone principle of ensuring Horizon's integrity. Although this has happened and is completely explainable, I don't think we ever want to expressly document it. And surely by removing reference to by the former sub-postmaster, you're making it less clear that that separation had been violated.
I accept that.
Again, strike out the word problem, replace it with issue, and then strike out the apology at the end. What was the problem legally with making an apology?
I think sometimes apologies can be interpreted as admissions, and it's not. I think it's pretty common for lawyers to, in letters, to consider whether the apology is appropriate or not.
Post office were, in this case, making an admission, weren't they?
Yes.
There had been an issue or a problem. It had been corrected, and this was a notification to the sub-postmaster that that had been corrected. What was the problem in this particular case of apologising for that?
In my view, it leads people to consider that there was, as I say, an admission of legal fault, when in fact Post Office's view is, yes, there had been a problem, but it was being corrected through proper channels.
And was that something that you regularly did on behalf of the Post Office?
It would depend on the circumstances.
Are there other letters where you would have removed apologies?
Possibly.
This is the other amendment. Made very similar amendments. If we scroll down, we can see reference to that thorough investigation. Do you see, in terms of the thorough investigation, is it likely that, in fact, the investigation was only in relation to this particular issue that had been identified? The 14 bug.
I can't now recall.
Do you recall any wider investigation that took place in relation to these sub-postmasters' branches, investigating their branch records, any wider than the identified issue in this particular case?
I can't recall.
Would you accept that reading that letter, it sounds as though a thorough investigation has taken place that is wider than simply one particular issue?
I could see how someone could read it that way, but I also think it's read in the context of looking at a particular issue.
And where does it explain that a particular issue has been thoroughly investigated?
Because it's targeting those specific discrepancies in the account.
Did you draft it intentionally so that it was ambiguous as to what the investigation had been into?
I don't believe so.
For example, why wouldn't it have said the Post Office has thoroughly investigated this issue? It says investigated your branch's records. It's drafted in quite a wide way. Would you accept that?
I can see how you could read it that way. I don't believe I gave it that level of thought at the time.
Can you see how the recipient may well read it that way?
I think they would have recognise that this was investigating a particular discrepancy and that's what was being investigated.
So it wasn't your intention to suggest a broader investigation than in fact had taken place?
Correct.
You email Roderick Williams, you say, Roderick, as discussed, please find attached a version of the letter for those sub-postmasters who are currently not aware of the situation. So there were letters going out to those who had actually made specific complaints, those who knew about the investigation, and then a third set of letters, which was to those who weren't already aware of the situation. Is that correct?
I can't now recall what that was in reference to.
But looking at this email, does it seem as though there was a further set of letters to sub-postmasters who were not currently aware of the situation?
My recollection is there were two versions of the letters, one for those who had suffered a loss, one for those who had suffered a gain. I don't recall whether there was a third version for another category.
Okay, well, let's have a look at the draft letter that's attached to this email that's sent in your name on the 27th of June 2013. This is the letter that was attached to your email. If we scroll down, we can see it's informing a sub-postmaster, and it says, branch discrepancies at, and it names the post office. You may have been aware of two small value unexplained discrepancies that have impacted your branch. In light of these discrepancies, post office has thoroughly investigated your branch's records, and whilst undertaking this investigation, we have ensured that any known discrepancies have not been charged to your account. I write now to confirm the outcome of our investigations. And it refers to a small value declaration that was amended. Looking at this, is this something you recall now? Does this assist?
It appears that the first paragraph has been changed.
This isn't a change. This is one that you sent independently. Mm. You said, please find attached a version of the letter. So it's a further letter to those who weren't aware, and it refers specifically to an issue in their particular post office, doesn't it?
Correct.
Do you think it's fair to say that a reader of this letter will be under the impression that, in fact, there are two small value discrepancies and that this is effectively a business as usual type correspondence, no explanation, for example, of it affecting other branches?
I couldn't comment on whether this was a business as usual type correspondence for post office to send.
Well, you were drafting the letters. Mm-hmm. You were assisting the post office drafting the letters. If you were to read this and you're a sub postmaster, do you think you might get the impression that you were the only one affected by this discrepancy?
You might get that impression.
Do you think you might get the impression that in fact it's only two small value discrepancies that have occurred?
In that branch.
But you wouldn't have known about other branches, would you?
Correct.
Again, was that the intention of this correspondence to suggest to the recipient of their correspondence that it was only them that was affected and that it wasn't a big deal?
I don't believe that was the intention.
Why in that correspondence not say to the recipient, you are one of a number of branches that have been affected by this issue?
I don't believe I gave that any consideration. The instruction was to draft a letter that was focused on each individual branch and explaining their position.
Same day, another email between yourself and Roderick Williams. Roderick Williams to yourself, saying, we discussed this yesterday, you mentioned this might have been kicking around for circa 12 months. Can you give me a couple of bullet points on when this first came up? And what the post office did next. See your response. The issue manifested in around 2011, and those sub-postmasters that suffered sizable errors, i.e. ones that were easy to spot, reported the issue immediately. So just pausing there, there were sub-postmasters who experienced sizable errors.
Yes.
So the correspondence we saw before about the two small value unexplained discrepancies, alongside those small value discrepancies, there were large ones.
That's my distant understanding, is there were some larger ones, yes.
However, as it was only a few branches, Chesterfield didn't see the pattern in the errors for over 12 months. It was only as more issues were raised, and no individual branch-by-branch explanation could be found, that someone, not sure who, realised that it could be an error in Horizon affecting multiple branches. I presume that it then took time to engage Fujitsu, investigate the technical causes, and determine the effect of the causes, etc. So this is a bug that occurred in 2011 that was only realised 12 months later, is that right?
I think that was my understanding at the time, based on what Andy Wynne had told me.
And we're now in 2013, summer of 2013, and so you presume it took time to engage Fujitsu, so considerable further period has taken place before sub-postmasters have received any correspondence on the issue, or received that correspondence explaining the issue.
That's my presumption at the time. I just would note that my understanding of this bug, its nature was that it was annually reoccurring.
Yes.
So it would only come up once a year, which was part of the context of this.
So it happened twice before it was actually spotted.
Correct.
You say that I presume that it took time to engage Fujitsu, investigate the technical causes, etc. Were you aware of the extent to which Fujitsu had been investigating the causes?
Not at this time.
So again, if we refer back to those letters that I took you to, where you referred to a thorough investigation, in fact, you personally weren't aware of the extent of the investigation.
I was working on the instructions provided to me by Andy Wynn.
Did you question those instructions?
I remember speaking to Andy Wynn and discussing the matter, but beyond that, I can't remember the details of those conversations.
So, we're still in the summer of 2013. You now, by this stage, know that there was this bug. Not just that sub-postmaster's records couldn't be kept separate from a successor sub-postmaster, but it was also a bug that went on for a year without anyone noticing and took even more time to resolve. Is that right?
Correct.
So, summer 2013, I'm going to put new of the suspense bug. You were concerned about its implications for accounting integrity?
Correct.
And you had in an email raised concerns about documenting that?
I'd raised concerns about documenting in these specific letters, not generally.
July 1st, 2013 now. An email from Simon Baker to Roderick Williams. Rod, it would be helpful if we can show that Horizon bugs were discussed openly in our court cases. We know that the Falkirk bug was discussed at the Misra case. Can you find out if there are any other examples where bugs have been discussed in court? And that request is ultimately sent to you. We can see that on and your answer on page one. We can see you say, other than Castleton and Misra, we're not aware of any litigation that has involved an allegation of an actual bug in Horizon. However, this is based on anecdotal discussions inside Bond Dickinson. Just pausing there, who had you spoken to inside Bond Dickinson?
I don't recall.
Please bear in mind that we've handled hundreds of cases over the last five to ten years for post office, so absent a case-by-case review, it's impossible to say for certain that no sub-postmaster alleged a Horizon bug. We are, however, confident that no case in the last 2 years has involved an allegation that there is a specific flaw in Horizon. Just pausing there, the first paragraph that I took you to refers to an actual bug. Mm-hmm. Third paragraph, we're talking about a specific flaw. Were those words quite carefully chosen in that what you're saying here is an actual bug that has been referred to, for example, by name or that is known about, rather than, for example, a wider problem with Horizon?
I don't think I meant any difference between those two phrases.
Well, you were aware that in that time, sub-postmasters had been raising problems with Horizon and that they couldn't necessarily pinpoint that to a specific or actual bug.
Yes.
There are a number of cases handled by our paralegal team that have been put on hold because a sub-postmaster has alleged problems with Horizon. So there are also some that are now on hold because I think Second Sight are investigating.
Correct.
These cases are suspended pending Second Sight report. It may be that on closer inspection, these cases reveal a specific complaint about an error in Horizon. However, we would need to undertake a deeper review of each case to determine this. On Castleton, I've spoken to the lawyer who conducted this litigation, which took place in 2007. Can you assist us who it was that you spoke to?
I can't recall, but I believe it would have been Stephen Dilly.
The case was principally about accounting records. The Horizon challenges by Castleton were generally uncoordinated and piecemeal. It should be borne in mind that Castleton was unrepresented, so there was no logical attack on Horizon. And you say, I'm still looking into Misra, and will report back soon. So, can I add here to my list of things in summer of 2013 that you knew about the Castleton case, you knew in broad terms, although not the specifics, about the Misra case, and you knew that other cases were on hold because of Horizon challenges.
I think the other... I knew both about those cases, and I think the other cases were generally all paused because the second site work was going on.
And you knew that they were paused because they were raising concerns about the integrity of the Horizon system.
That's what it says there, but I can't recall that now.
Second site interim report is then the 8th of July 2013. We see there the bugs that are referred to by, or they're referred to as defects in the second site report. The first is the receipts and payments mismatch problem impacting 62 branches. Second is the local suspense account problem. That's the 14 branch issue that you had already been dealing with.
I've been drafting the letters on.
6.10, there's also another bug. I think that's the calendar square Falkirk bug. It says Paul has informed us that it's disclosed in witness statements to English courts information about one other subsequently corrected defect or bug in the Horizon software. And that was, in fact, the issue that you were looking into on behalf of Roderick Williams, wasn't it? You were looking into whether there were other bugs that had been disclosed in court cases.
Correct.
And Misra was one that you were going to come back to him on. Presumably you did come back to him on Misra.
Yes, I believe we had someone review the case.
Yes. Because I'm going to add, we're in the summer of 2013, 8th of July, at least three bugs known to you.
I knew of three bugs in that at that time.
Yes. Cartwright King's advice on Gareth Jenkins now, dated the 15th of July 2013, you dealt with it in your witness statement. 16th of July 2013, Susan Crichton emails you. We received a letter from the CCRC, Criminal Cases Review Commission, yesterday, which I have asked Cartwright King to review. Their advice feels odd to me, as if given or on a take-it-or-leave-it basis, and I'm not comfortable that's particularly useful in this context. Could we discuss? I'm happy to go to another firm that specialises in criminal law or a barrister. Somehow it feels as if there's a conflict here, which I'm not sure I understand. Over the page, there's advice given by Gavin Matthews. So he was your supervising partner, was he, at this stage?
Correct.
He says, I know that you are with Simon and Andy today, so I've taken an initial look at this for you. So, on the 16th of July, is Andy a reference to you? Were you meeting with Susan Crichton on the 16th of July?
I think that is a reference to me, but I don't recall that meeting.
He says, I agree with you that I would expect the advice to me to be more prescriptive, i.e. you need to say this in response. I do also have concerns from a civil point of view over a couple of statements in the draft response. So this is the draft response to the Criminal Cases Review Commission. That had been drafted by Cartwright King. And he says, in particular, where it states, he has done so both to the post office and in expert witness statements and oral evidence to the court. In particular, he has attested to the presence of defect detection and rectification systems, the robustness of the prosecution audit trail, and stated that, in his expert opinion, Horizon accurately records and processes all information submitted into the system. The second site interim report demonstrates that this was not the case. So that's there a reference to Gareth Jenkins, isn't it?
Yes.
Yes. And your supervising partner there is raising a concern about that being included in the letter to the Criminal Cases Review Commission.
Yes.
He says, I consider this to be unhelpful, given that the second site report found there to be no systemic problems with Horizon. It shows the need for all post office letters, criminal and civil, to contain a consistent message, so that the right hand and the left hand know what they are each doing. Were you aware that that was the advice from your firm, that there needed to be greater coordination between the criminal and the civil sides?
I was copied to this email.
Yes, so you were aware.
I was aware.
Not just from this email, but perhaps from conversations with your supervising partner?
I don't believe before this point my firm had any involvement in the criminal side, so there may have been no conversations before this email was sent.
So from this point on, the approach of your firm was, and the advice to the post office was, that we need to coordinate more between the criminal and the civil side.
I think that is an early comment from Gavin which will have been the first time we've been asked to consider the crossover between the civil and criminal side. And as he goes on to say later down, he notes he's not a criminal lawyer and he suggests that they get advice from a criminal barrister.
Another email from Gavin Matthews. You were presumably at this stage very much aware of the Gareth Jenkins issues because you were meeting Susan Crichton that very day.
I think I'd been informed a few days earlier that there was something to do with Gareth Jenkins. But I wasn't fully aware of the issues until I received a copy of the advice from Cartwright.
Thank you. And we'll go through that advice shortly. Gavin Matthews emails Susan Crichton and says, Susan, I thought I would give you my preliminary views on this pending our call. Were you involved in a call on that day? I know you met her, I think, on the 16th. Do you recall a call the next day?
No. At this time, I was mainly focused on looking at the response to Second Sight, because their report had just been published.
The post office needs to look at the response to the CCRC in the context of the overall strategic advice received from Cartwright King, including their advice regarding Gareth Jenkins / Fujitsu. If the post office suffers losses directly referable to Gareth Jenkins' failure to comply with his obligations as an expert witness, there are three potential entities against whom the post office may have an action: Gareth Jenkins, Fujitsu, and Cartwright King. Four is, given that Cartwright King are potentially liable to the post office for any failure on the part of Gareth Jenkins / Fujitsu, I do think it would be sensible to get a criminal QC to oversee the strategic advice being given by Cartwright King. I'm not saying that Cartwright King have definitely done anything wrong, but they may have done and are trying to blame Gareth Jenkins / Fujitsu, so it's very important to check that their tactical approach is now overseen by someone completely unbiased. And we'll see in due course advice is sought from their criminal QC. We'll look at that advice. First, though, Martin Smith sends Susan Crichton the Simon Clark's advice on Gareth Jenkins, and we can see that Susan Crichton sends you the advice, and that's on that same day, 17th of July, 2013. This is Cartwright King's advice, the Clark advice on Gareth Jenkins, entitled Prosecution's Expert Evidence, page 5. Expert evidence relied upon by the post office in prosecuting offences. For many years, both the Royal Mail Group and latterly the post office has relied upon Dr. Gareth Jenkins for the provision of expert evidence as to the operation and integrity of Horizon. So you were aware at this stage that the post office had been relying on Gareth Jenkins for a number of years to provide expert evidence.
That's what I took from this advice.
Yes. Paragraph 15, Dr. Jenkins had provided many expert statements in support of the Post Office and Royal Mail Group prosecutions. So lots more than one, plenty of a number of different expert statements. And was that your understanding?
Yes, having read those words.
Paragraph 37, what does this all mean? In short, it means that, and that should read Gareth Jenkins, has not complied with his duties to the court, the prosecution, or the defence. Paragraph 38, the reasons as to why Gareth Jenkins failed to comply with his duty are beyond the scope of this review. The effects of the failure, however, must be considered. I advise the following to be the position. Gareth Jenkins failed to disclose material known to him, but which undermines his expert opinion. This failure is a breach of his duty as an expert witness. Accordingly, his credibility as an expert witness is fatally undermined. He should not be asked to provide expert evidence in any current or future prosecution. We see there that first bullet point on the page. It says, not least by reason of Gareth Jenkins' failure, material which should have been disclosed to defendants was not disclosed, thereby placing the post office in breach of their duty as a prosecutor. By reason of that failure to disclose, there are a number of now convicted defendants to whom the existence of bugs should have been disclosed, but was not. Those defendants remain entitled to have disclosure of that material, notwithstanding their now convicted status. Further, there are also a number of current cases where there has been no disclosure where there ought to have been. Here we must disclose the existence of the bugs to these defendants, where the test for disclosure is met. A very serious advice, one that you presumably took very seriously at that time.
I read it, but this was within the remit of the criminal lawyers to deal with.
But it's not just dealing with the existence of bugs that we've already seen you were aware of throughout the summer of 2013, but by now, potential miscarriages of justice. Was that not something that played on your mind at all?
It was a serious matter, but it looked like to me it was being addressed by Cartwright King, and then subsequently Post Office understood the seriousness, which is why they brought in Brian Altman.
There were sub-postmasters who had been convicted on the back of that evidence. Presumably, irrespective of your day job, you were concerned about that.
I could see the seriousness of the matter.
This then sets in motion a number of different actions, one of which is this regular call regarding Horizon issues. Do you recall those regular calls?
I recall the calls as a concept. I don't recall any of the individual ones.
Well, here we have the first of those, which was presumably significant in the sense that it was the very first. 19th of July 2013. You are named as an attendee. Do you recall attending that first regular call?
I don't recall attending that call, but I have no reason to doubt that I was there.
There are two entries from you that are recorded in these minutes. Can we please look at the first? It says, Andrew Parsons commented on the need to limit public debate on the Horizon issue, as this may have a detrimental impact on future litigation. Andrew Parsons stated all lists and spreadsheets should be sent to Rosie Gaisford for collection. Spoke about emails, written comms, etc. If it's produced, it's then available for disclosure. If it's not, then technically it isn't. Is that accurate?
I don't believe this minute is a verbatim record of what was said. And so I suspect some of the context or wider language used has been lost somewhere. I don't think it would be unsurprising for me to have given Post Office advice on what its civil disclosure duties might be, and that's what's being given there.
And do you see the civil disclosure duty to be, if it isn't produced, it's then available for disclosure? If it's not, then technically it isn't.
This is talking about the fact that in civil rules of disclosure attached to documents, which is information that's recorded.
Can you see that it might be interpreted as advice that people shouldn't be writing things down?
No.
Martin Smith has given evidence to this inquiry, and he said that you also spoke at the beginning of the meeting, after Rob King, and you raised concerns about difficulties which could arise following circulation of minutes. Do you recall advising of concerns about the circulation of minutes?
I don't recall advising on minutes at all in these meetings. These calls were set up by the criminal lawyers, and they were driving the process.
A contemporaneous piece of advice from Cartwright King, it's what we know as the shredding advice, or what's been referred to as the shredding advice, disclosure, the duty to record and retain material. It summarises the information that's been given to Mr. Clark. It says, at some point following the conclusion of the third conference call, which I understand to have taken place on the morning of Wednesday the 31st of July, it became unclear as to whether and to what extent material was either being retained centrally or disseminated. He summarises the various bits of information that he's received, and he says, advice has been given to POL, to the Post Office, which I report as relayed to me verbatim. If it's not minuted, it's not in the public domain and therefore not disclosable. If it's produced, it's available for disclosure. If not minuted, then technically it's not. Again, those are the words in effect that we saw in those minutes and moments ago. This is a contemporaneous document. It was drafted, written on the 2nd of August 2013. That sounds very much like the advice that's attributed to you in that first meeting. Do you agree with that?
No, I think the wording is different between the two documents. And as I say, I didn't produce those minutes and I didn't approve those minutes. I don't think something's been accurately recorded in them. To be clear, I never advised Post Office that they should not minute those calls. And until the suggestion that there was some connection between what I had said and this advice was raised in this inquiry, I had no idea that there was any connection with anything I'd done.
There is a body of evidence that the inquiry has seen that suggests that your advice to the post office was not to keep a paper trail.
I disagree. I did not advise post office against minuting those meetings.
There is some evidence that you advised caution in minute-taking. Do you agree with that?
In the context of this, I did not advise post office not to minute those calls.
Do you think that those who were present at meetings with you could have got the impression from the advice that you were giving at those meetings that they should be careful about writing things down?
I think they would have got the impression that they would be subject to disclosure duties, which is what I'd advise them. Had I said something to the effect that all could have been interpreted to mean that they shouldn't be taking minutes, I would have expected Martin Smith from Cartwright King, who was on those calls, to have said something, and nothing was said.
But that can come down, thank you. Do you think that you gave advice to the post office that they shouldn't write things down because they would be disclosable?
No.
This is an issue we're going to come back to. Given your answer just now, I would like to give you the opportunity to address it. This is around the same time, July 2013, 24th of July, Susan Crichton emails you and says, Andy, could you take a look at this draft letter to go to our insurance broker regarding the Horizon issue? I've not looked at it. Your response? The letter does nothing more than put the post office's insurers on notice of the Horizon issues. It's very bland. My only hesitation is whether it's strictly necessary to do so. From a PR perspective, it would look bad if this got into the public domain, sign of guilt / concern from the board. I'll be happy to have one of our insurance lawyers look over the D&O policy to see if the post office is required to notify the insurers. If not, then we might want to hold a fire on this. I would recommend tweaking the first paragraph. The current version suggests there are problems with Horizon, when at present there are no systemic problems to report. There comes a time when you've spoken to the lawyers who looked over the D&O cover. You say, as follows, I've spoken to one of our insurance lawyers regarding the D&O cover. And it's the last three paragraphs I'd like to look at. You say, the risk of notification is that it will look bad for the post office if it ever became public knowledge that the post office had notified its insurer. To reduce the risk, it is recommended that rather than sending a formal written notification, the post office speaks to Chartist, renamed AIG, and verbally notifies them so as not to leave a paper trail. In our experience, AIG may be prepared to accept a verbal notification. Post office should make expressly clear to AIG that the notification is subject to litigation privilege. This should help protect against disclosure under the Freedom of Information Act. Are you not there in July 2013 giving advice to the post office that they shouldn't write something down, that they should communicate it only verbally?
In the context of this insurance point, but earlier we were talking about the minutes of those calls.
My question was much broader earlier. I said to you, have you ever advised the post office not to write something down? And here we are, July 2013, precisely the same period in which that advice is attributed to you, doing exactly that, aren't you?
In which case, I apologise because I misunderstood your question. I thought you were asking it in the context of the minutes of that Horizon call.
So you are accepting that in July 2013, at the same period of time, you did advise the post office not to communicate in writing to their insurer, not to notify their insurer, because that would become disclosable. But for some reason, the minutes that are attributed to you regarding very similar advice, those are wrong, are they?
I don't accept it was very similar advice. The advice that was recorded in those minutes, which, as I said, they're not verbatim minutes and I'm not sure of their accuracy, simply records the position that documents need to be disclosed if they're created. This is talking about a different matter, which is communications with the insurance company. And actually, ultimately, off the back of this, a written notification was provided to the insurers.
Yes, but your advice in July 2013, the same period in which this first Horizon weekly call is taking place, mm-hmm. was don't notify something because it will be disclosable. Isn't that the advice you are giving in relation to minutes on the 19th of July 2013?
No, they are two separate pieces of advice in different contexts where I say different things.
They are remarkably similar, though, aren't they?
No, I don't believe they are. I think the first one is talking about the disclosability of documents. It doesn't say anything in that minute about me saying that minutes should not be kept or documents should not be produced. And then we're now 10 days later talking in a different context about insurance issues.
But it's the same point, that if you write things down about Horizon, about problems with Horizon, it might become disclosable.
But that's correct.
You shouldn't do that.
Apologies. That's correct.
That is correct.
Well, that is the state of the law. If you write documents down, you create documents, they can become disclosable.
And therefore, you shouldn't create such documents.
I disagree.
But that is, in fact, what you're advising in relation to the insurance.
As I say, it depends on the context in which the question is put.
Okay, let me take you to your explanation in your witness statement. I do not understand the reference to produced in the comment that is attributed to me. The word produced is not a word I would ordinarily use in this context. I think of the word produced in the context of running a production of documents from a data room, which is a technical e-discovery process, which are then given to the other side in civil litigation as part of disclosure. I would not use the word when describing the creation of new documents by my client, which are then potentially disclosable. The use of this word suggests to me that the note is not an accurate record of precisely what was said. So I'll just repeat the words that are in the minutes. It is spoke about emails, written comms, etc. If it's produced, it's then available for disclosure. If it's not, then technically it isn't. And your explanation in your witness statement is, that doesn't sound like me. I don't use the word produced in that context. Is that right?
I generally don't. I consider it in the context of running productions of documents.
That's quite an elaborate explanation, isn't it, that's set out at paragraph 105?
No, I think it's also reflecting, if you look at the minute, it's clearly a short précis of what was said. It doesn't stand to be a verbatim minute. And therefore, I think there is probably some inaccuracy in the minute taking.
And your basis for saying that the minute is inaccurate is, amongst other things, that you don't use that word in that context.
Amongst other things, but also reading the minute as a whole, I think it's obvious that it's not a verbatim minute.
It's an email from you. You say as follows, Pete, Matthew, Dave. As part of the court process, the experts on both sides have to meet to try and agree a joint statement on the key issues in the case. This has resulted in them producing four joint statements. These statements are produced without the involvement of the legal teams, hence why we haven't sent over these to Fujitsu for comments before now. Another email from you, again, context doesn't matter. Turn over to the third page, please. There are points there. The draft order also sets out our proposed directions to the March 2019 trial. These split out into four phases, and then we look at phase three. These, the experts produce their principal reports into Horizon. Phase four, supplemental reports are produced in light of anything coming out of the common issues trial. Your witness statement in the Alan Bates case, fourth witness statement, if we scroll down, you say in the second half of that paragraph, you say to attempt to locate all of the training materials, Post Office would need to contact all trainers since 2000 to understand what materials were produced and where they were kept. That's a witness statement to the court, verified by a statement of truth. Do you want to revisit that part of your witness statement in these proceedings, which said that the word produced is not a word that you would use in that kind of a context?
I think my statement says I would not ordinarily use this word. I clearly have used that word on occasion.
Do you therefore want to revisit whether that minute reflects the advice that you gave to the first of those meetings? That if it's produced, it's available for disclosure. If it's not, then technically it isn't.
I still believe that that minute is not a full and accurate record of what was said in that meeting. I think you only have to read the minute to realise it's not a verbatim record.
And is it still your position, therefore, that you didn't advise caution in relation to the creation of minutes because of their potential disclosure?
I did not advise Post Office against minuting those meetings.
Thank you, sir. I think that's an appropriate time for our first morning break.